Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
The ongoing coronavirus pandemic is turning us all into virologists, epidemiologists, futurologists, and God knows what. But more seriously, what it is doing is it's making us learn more about a universe that we had known very little about, or in fact, nothing about. So for a political journalist like me, I had very little idea of how medical research works, how medical journals work, but you keep learning all the time. That's the reason I said, now we've been with this virus for almost 4 months, in fact, a little more than 4 months globally, and this will go on for another 6 at least, if not longer. So we are learning. So one thing we have learned now, and everything forces you to read and have people who help you with research also read, we've learned something about the world of medical journals. So when you think of medical journals, reputed medical journals where research appears, first of all, you say, are these journals peer-reviewed or not? Which means before publishing, has the data, conclusions, research methodology, ethics, conflicts of interest been studied by people of equal or higher stature and examined? Because this research is important, people's lives and deaths can depend on it. Then these journals are rated in terms of what is their impact rating. Now, this is not something that I knew anything about earlier. Now, impact factor, as it's called, impact factor for a journal, the higher the impact factor, the more respected the journal. And I will tell you how, and I will also tell you how the impact factor is calculated. But before that, let me tell you why I'm getting into this today. And those of you who are into research and who are doctors may find it a bit juvenile, but for the rest of us, it's new. For me, definitely it was new, I'll tell you. But let me first tell you why we are talking about such an esoteric subject. That's because if you look at respected medical journals around the world, across the world, if I asked you, and you were a lay person, name the most important medical journal, chances are that most of you would say The Lancet, right? That is the British journal. Then if you are a little bit more knowledgeable, and these days everybody reads everything that comes out in coronavirus, you might mention couple more journals, say Journal of American Medical Association, JAMA, or Indian Journal of Medical Research, IJMR as it's called, or New England Journal of Medicine, NEJM. Now, the two most prestigious journals, medical journals in the world, are The Lancet and NEJM. They are both with a high impact factor. The Lancet with 59.102, it's that finally calculated, and NEJM with 70.67, very high, and I will explain to you what impact factor is and how it's calculated. Both these journals, the reputation of both of the world's finest and greatest journals, one founded in 1823, that is The Lancet, so in 3 years, it will be 200 years old, it will be its 200th anniversary. And NEJM, founded even earlier in 1811, it's already 209 years old. Reputations built over two centuries, they've been taken down, at least for now, by a bunch of very well-qualified doctors and medical researchers. Unfortunately, three of them, in fact, the core of these researchers who've unfortunately taken down the two of the world's greatest journals right now for their reputation, it's a big setback for their reputations in a crucial time, are Indian, of Indian origin. One is Dr. Mandeep R. Mehra, has an MD, Harvard University. One is Sapan Desai, has an MD and PhD. He runs a data company called SurgiSphere, which is at the heart of this trouble. Third Indian here is Amit Patel in University of Utah, Salt Lake City. Now, these three people feature in both these studies. Now, the study at Lancet, The study at Lancet was a large study. They said that they studied the data from 671 hospitals across six continents. And from that data, they looked at 81,000 patients, hospitalized patients who were not given hydroxychloroquine, and 15,000 who were given. And based on data, that data, they arrived at a conclusion, one, that HCQ was not benefiting anybody, and second, that the evidence that the incidence of heart rate irregularities, heart irregularities, cardiac irregularities, and cardiac irregularity related fatalities or deaths was considerably higher among those being given hydroxychloroquine. We spoke about it, I think, in our episode 484. Now, what happened as a result of that? As a result of that, one, doctors around the world who were using hydroxychloroquine as a possible treatment, therapy, stopped. Or most of them stopped. In India, they did not stop because ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, did not accept it. The holy, venerable World Health Organization, based on this, temporarily halted all their ongoing research as part of their global solidarity trial involving hydroxychloroquine. A little fine print there was that the research that they published in the Lancet did not talk about just hydroxychloroquine. It talked about hydroxychloroquine in combination with what is called as microlides, which is antibiotics in the azithromycin category. So this was azithromycin plus hydroxychloroquine. In fact, Indian doctors would tell you, ICMR tells you, that it is well known that with azithromycin and hydroxychloroquine together can cause problems. Nevertheless, this research was based on observational data, but it was a large enough data, 671 hospitals in six continents. After that, we had mentioned to you in that earlier Cut the Clutter, 180 scientists and doctors from around the world wrote a joint letter to The Lancet saying they were not convinced with this research because they wanted to see the primary data on which this was based, because discrepancies came up in the number of people that this study claimed had died in six hospitals from Australia, although by that date, that many people had not died in those hospitals. And the immediate defense was, oh, that's because there was a mistake. A hospital in Asia registered itself as Australian. Now, when that happened, one chink in the armor opened up. And so these 180 scientists wanted to be shown the primary data. Now, these are peer-reviewed journals. So this research had gone through a peer review process. When these researchers, other researchers, or doubters asked for the data, The Lancet also went back to the authors of the paper for the data, and the authors of the paper were not able to furnish the data. Then The Lancet set up a second review of the peer review, and those reviewers also came to the conclusion that this company which brought this data, Surgisphere, is not willing to share any data with us, citing client confidentiality. Now, you can't cite client confidentiality retrospectively after having published research of very serious medical significance. Think of the significance of this, that people who were being given HCQ were stopped being given HCQ because it was seen to be dangerous. In fact, even in India, there were many questions. Why is ICMR killing people with HCQ, either for treatment or for prophylactic use? This study became a big shot in the arm of the anti-HCQ community. So a lot of people who were being given that medication stopped it. Now, it's possible that it may be beneficial, may indeed be beneficial or not harmful, and maybe many of those people who have died subsequently, maybe many of them would have survived if they were continued on this treatment, because we don't know if HCQ works. But we also know now that the research that shows that HCQ does serious harm was fake. It was based on data that nobody can share with you. That means the research is fake. So when this pressure came and the protests came, The Guardian did a very major story, a wonderful Guardian reporter. You will see her story here. And that story, in fact, found out that this data company, the key employees of that company included one who's a science fiction writer and one who's a who's an adult movie star. So it looks like it was just I'm sorry to use a strong word, but that this was a scandal. Now, once this happened, these authors wrote to The Lancet an apology, a groveling, humble apology, withdrawing the study. The Lancet also said they regret having published it and they took the study down. Now, for a 297-year-old journal, among the most respected in the world, it's more than the Bible, because the Bible might be believed only by Christians and a few others, but this is believed by everybody, Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Jew. All doctors, all medical personnel or health journalists believe The Lancet. The Lancet was taken for a right royal ride in this case. Why The Lancet did that? It's quite evident, because Lancet, if you see The Lancet editorials lately, and I was not a regular reader, but last several months I'm a regular reader. I find that those have become very politicized, very ideological, and very polarized. HCQ, we told you, is a drug which had got polarized simply because Donald Trump, without medical advice, was plugging it to the world, and Narendra Modi, India being the monopoly manufacturer, was giving it to the whole world and getting plaudits for it. So you put Modi and Trump on one side and put on their side a humble drug, which costs nothing. I think I had mentioned this earlier, the total value of HCQ produced in India, our wonderful pharma and health correspondent Himani Channa tells me, is just 172 crores. In fact, India produces Calpol, which is your regular paracetamol drug, worth 184 crores. So it's a very cheap drug. So you add Trump, Modi, a very cheap drug, and you find the entire lot of Modi Trump critics turned on you and turned on poor HCQ. So it became the most politicized drug in our history, and I do think it's quite evident that The Lancet also let its guard down, because as even that Guardian story pointed out, the entire process of beginning to write this report, sending it to Lancet, peer review and publication took just 5 weeks. 5 weeks in the middle of a pandemic. This is like working under some kind of a news agency deadline pressure, that I have to get this story out by this time, whatever happens. But it would also seem that this is the conclusion the editors of The Lancet may have liked. So once they got the conclusion they liked, they lowered their guard and ended up publishing this piece of, if I may say so, complete rubbish. Complete rubbish, which obviously endangered many lives. In my book, this is a criminal offense. People who did this, particularly the researchers, they should be investigated. This data firm should also be investigated, because we don't know where it was coming from. I'll tell you something. I don't believe in conspiracy theories, but Nassim Nicholas Taleb, who is a futurologist from France, many of you have read him. He wrote the book Black Swan. He tweeted late last night that the big corporations have lost, science has won. What does it mean? What it means is that if HCQ is even a little bit effective, then some newly discovered molecule that might work for COVID-19, say remdesivir, I'm not making any allegations or any insinuations, say remdesivir or any other favipiravir or any of the new molecules, if HCQ is even 30% effective, then the value of such a molecule, new molecule, is maybe $500 million. But if HCQ is not effective, which means if nothing, no existing cheap drug is effective, then the value of the same molecule may be $10 billion. That's where now I think there'll be a great deal of insinuation. It needs investigation that did HCQ run into a big campaign? I've not used that expression before, because I like big industry, and I'm not against big pharma, but it will lead itself to questions about whether it was the big pharma which was behind this completely fake research based on data nobody could furnish to knock down a very cheap drug. So that is a big loss of face, and this is for the Lancet. Groveling apology from the Lancet and from the authors. And as I told you, Lancet has an impact factor of 59.102. Now, if you think this was enough, then you might dismiss it as one-off. See something else that happened on the same day. In fact, a day earlier, 3rd June, 4th June. So this has happened like a 1-2 punch on the medical research community. The same authors with some other authors. So the same three that I told you about, Mandeep Mehra, Sapan Desai and Amit Patel. In this case, with Shriram Kui, K-U-Y, from Baylor College, Texas, all reputed institutions. Timothy Henry from Christ Hospital, Cincinnati. And the three of these people that I named, they produced another study which was published in New England Journal of Medicine. Venerable one set up in 1811 with an impact factor of 70.67, even higher than the Lancet. That study said on May 1, that was a study again based on this data on whether the most popular blood pressure drugs in the world, a drug that everybody's been asking questions about, or a category of drugs called ACE inhibitors and ARB inhibitors. That is your Cardace, Losar, Telma. A lot of the people in India, a large number of people over the age of 40, 45 now take those drugs because those are the safest, the most effective blood pressure drugs. It's also part of the compulsory protocol for diabetics, even if they are not suffering from hypertension. So these are drugs consumed at a very mass level. So initially, when it came out that coronavirus latches onto your ACE2 receptors, then immediate questions arose that then if you're having these ACE inhibitors, these drugs, do they then weaken your body's ability to deal with the coronavirus? Or does it make it easier for coronavirus to latch onto your ACE2 inhibitors? Logically, just thinking logically, it would seem yes. So initially there was a lot of fear and a lot of people stopped taking that. But no real research came up to say, big research came up to say that this was dangerous. In fact, very early on, many of the regulators in many key countries, including in India, ICMR, issued an advisory saying that there is no evidence that this is harmful. So please continue taking it. In fact, you will see on the screen a story based on that advisory and that advisory as well. So please keep taking it. And if you want to change it or whatever, check with your doctor. We are not doctors. Once again, nothing we say should be taken as a prescription to start taking something or to stop taking something. That only a doctor knows. But these are widely consumed blood pressure drugs. Then a couple of studies came out, which in fact two studies were published by New England Journal of Medicine, that said that they had found some harmful effects of these drugs. Those studies caused concern. Now the same lot of researchers with two others, as I listed them for you, they came up with another study which was published on May 1 by New England Journal of Medicine, saying that they had found that there was no evidence to suggest that these drugs were harmless, which means that these drugs could be harmful. So they did not find from their data and research anything to substantiate those studies that might have said that the drugs are harmless. On the other hand, this opened the doors again to the impression that these drugs may be harmful, which means people could have stopped having those drugs. Now, this was just a complete confusion. Once again, several scientists wrote to NEJM expressing doubts and wanting to see the data. And once again in their process, the same researchers said, we can't share the data. So what's happened? Now these researchers have again apologized and withdrawn that study. And New England Journal of Medicine has also withdrawn that study and apologized. So think about it, that three Indian scientists have ruined the reputation of two of the world's finest medical journals. over issues which are issues of life and death for millions of people around the world. Because remember, coronavirus is more lethal the older you are. And the older you are, more the chances that you're having blood pressure drugs. And more the chances that you have heart issues. So hydroxychloroquine, if you have a heart issue, yes or no, etc., etc. Those calculations come in. So two big journals, two studies, three Indian researchers. Yes, you must remember, I must also point out that even in the first study, the HCQ study, there is a fourth researcher. He is Frank Ruschitza, who's not Indian, but the essential drivers are these three Indians. Now, I told you, I'll tell you about how this impact factor is calculated. So essentially what this means is, if you are now looking at 2020, if you add up all the papers, citable papers, not editorials as Lancet often writes, citable papers, research papers that a journal published in the previous 2 years, the number of times those papers have been cited by peer-reviewed journals all over the world, that divided by the total number of articles, citable articles published. So A is the total number of times your papers were cited. 2 is the total number of papers published by you. A divided by B gives you the impact factor. That we told you for NEJM is 70.67, for the Lancet is 59.102, for another major global, globally reputed medical journal, JAMA, Journal of American Medical Association, is 51.273, and just for comparison, Indian Journal of Medical Research, IJMR, is 2.06. Now you might suddenly recoil thinking, why is the Indian journal rated so low? That's because not that much cutting edge medical research does happen in India, unfortunately. So whatever happens comes into here. IJMR is also a peer reviewed journal, so respect it. But I'm just telling you that if IJMR is 2, JAMA is 51, Lancet is 59, and NEJM is 70.67. These two big daddies, these are the two titanics of medical research. They've been taken down by three Desi champions. I am very sorry to say that, but that's the reality. In fact, now we have to think very carefully every time we see any bit of new research, and we've had this trouble. For example, some of us have been quoting for preprints and things because everybody is in a hurry to put out research now. And some of those things have not worked out. For example, I remember quoting from a preprint that said that heat, as the temperatures turn high, the virus may go down. Hasn't yet happened. There were some others that said humidity will bring it down. Let us see what happens when the monsoon comes. So research is moving all the time, but a preprint which is not peer-reviewed, which is not published, that's a different thing. But something that is peer-reviewed in the world's two most respected medical journals, it tells you that in the academic world, there is a principle, or that's cynically called publish or perish, which means you're under pressure to publish. Otherwise, someone else will publish and you will get left behind. But this is like publish and kill, publish and massacre. You publish and other people perish. Why should such respected journals be in such a hurry to publish this research, which looks dodgy to begin with? In fact, if you ask me as an editor, as a normal news type editor, if I had seen this, I would have raised these obvious questions that all the scientists have raised, unless it was a story that I really wanted published, never mind the facts. But this is not some tabloid. You are not publishing The Sun. The Lancet is not The Sun. Or the Lancet is not Karanjia's Blitz from the past, or the back page of the Blitz. This is a big setback now for these big medical journals. And I think medical researching community has to review this very carefully. But once again, before you make any change on the medication you are having, consult your doctor.